I should get through this introduction very quickly, but I have some news to report to you. The topic, I hope everyone doesn't leave, Comet Impact, Lessons Learned. That's not the topic for tonight.
Oh.
Refunds will be available. Instead, the topic is going to be 12 years on the 18-inch Schmidt telescope. And I think we all know about Carolyn Shoemaker by reading about her in the program. That she was born in Gallup, New Mexico, the same year that there was the stock market crash on but also the same year that Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, unbeknownst to anyone on this planet, decided to stop orbiting the Sun and start orbiting, ever so gently, the planet Jupiter. It thought it had a good thing going. But if we've all read our page, we would know that Carolyn received her bachelor's and master's degrees from Chico State College in 1949 and 1950, and along with her husband Gene, who is in the audience tonight, she was awarded the Rittenhouse Medal from the Rittenhouse Astronomical Society in 1988. And it says that Dr. Shoemaker's career has been both fascinating and eventful. Since 1980, she has served as a visiting scientist at the astrogeology branch of the U.S. That is terrible. Forget it. I'm introducing one half of the most precious couple that I have ever worked with in my entire life. I'm going to begin that way. And it began in the year 1968 when I was at Acadia University and I was taking Geology 100. At the time, I wanted more than anything else to be an astronomer, a professional astronomer. And the professor there started to talk about the Earth and the long geologic history of the Earth. And I talked with him afterwards about the possibility of becoming an astronomer by going through the geological door. And Dr. Stevens took me into his office, and for about an hour he talked about Gene Shoemaker. He talked about this man who had founded the science of astrogeology, who had single-handedly opened up the world of geology to the rest of our solar system. And he was setting up at the U.S. Geological Survey, he was setting up a new branch of astrogeology. Maybe, David, George Stevens said, you would like to be a part of the research that's going on. 1968 was just 1 year before the moon landing. And as we all watched a few months later, what many of us will think is the most stunning moment in the U.S. space program, when on Christmas Eve, we had live from the moon, and the astronauts were radioing back to us to have a Merry Christmas to all on the good green Earth. It was a stunning statement. It was something that transcended astronomy, transcended astrogeology, transcended everything for a whole world. And I thought, maybe someday I will get to work with the person who trained the astronauts, the person who got these astronauts ready for their geologic work on the moon. I didn't know that it was going to be 20 years before that was happened to me. But in March of 1988, I was searching for comets with my telescope in Tucson, Arizona, and I discovered a comet. I have a fairly slow brain when it comes to finding a comet, and it took me 3 days before I realized that it was a comet and not a couple of misplaced galaxies. And I reported that comet. It was named for me, as is the tradition for naming comets. 500 miles away, at the 18-inch telescope, Gene and Carolyn Shoemaker and Henry Holt were observing. And they heard about the discovery of this comet. And to give you an idea of the type of people they are, as soon as the announcement came, they looked at each other and they said, "We've just met David. He's discovered a comet. Let's turn our telescope to it and be the first to obtain a photographic position so that an orbit of the new comet can be calculated." And they did that. An orbit was calculated. Everything went fine. My comet was going on its merry way, rounding the sun, as Leslie Peltier would have said, signing its sweeping flourish in the guest book of the sun. But then they came back to Palomar. Now, by this time, Carolyn Shoemaker had been working for 8 years with her husband, Gene, on a project at Palomar to study asteroids, the asteroids that could be in danger of striking the Earth at some day, and to find comets. This was about the seventh or eighth year of their collaboration at Palomar. And they were pretty used to making discoveries. Eventually, Carolyn would be credited with the discovery of some 800 asteroids. I will name them now. And this was their next observing run. And I know that Carolyn tonight is going to describe the procedure by which we have observed all these years. But I don't know that she's going to describe just how frantic that procedure is. On a good observing run that lasts over a week, we might get over 300 8-minute exposures covering a good part of the sky. And that entails loading the telescope, opening the shutter, guiding it for 8 minutes, trying not to fall asleep against the eyepiece while you're doing that. And if I were to fall asleep, Carolyn would surely tell me when she looked at this film and saw what the resulting star trails on it. And then to take the film out of the telescope, develop the film, finish it, put it into the bag, finally to take the films out of their bags, put them in a stereo microscope, and search finally for comets or asteroids on those films. For 300 films, it's 150 pairs of films, to do that in 1 week, to be going up and down the 12.1 stairs leading from the basement to the observing floor so that the decimal point falls out very quickly. To do it for clear night after clear night from about on a winter's night from 4:45 in the evening to about 6:15 in the morning. So that we're looking at the sky after 4 or 5 nights and seeing that it's completely clear and saying to each other, "Wow, it's clear." And thinking to ourselves, "It's clear." So by the end of the observing run, getting a little tired. And on this particular observing run, the idea of observing my comet on the second to last night, when it was higher in the morning sky, had come to Gene and Carolyn. And they create a list of fields to take, plotted on a piece of paper, where each circular field is plotted with a nickel, not a Canadian nickel. It has these sides on it. You couldn't use that. It had to be a good old-fashioned American nickel. And so it's called the nickel diagram. And each nickel represents a field, which is fine, except like many things that I do, my comets do not fall in these nickel diagram fields. Mine was way over. So Gene made a note, David's comet, and put it in the top upper left field. And by the end of that observing run, they turned the telescope to that upper field, forgetting that the comet was really way, way in another whole different field. They took the picture. They took another picture 45 minutes later. And the following night, Carolyn started to scan those two films, looking to see if the moving comet would give itself away as a floating object. What an elegant way of finding a comet. She found it very quickly, and she called Gene. Gene came down, carefully looked through, focused, took his glasses off, put them back on again, said a few things, and then said, "Why is this comet not in the middle of this field? Why is it off to the side, Carolyn?" And Carolyn said, "I don't know. Well, you got this field for us." And the sky was getting dark. Gene and Henry Holt were ready to start. Gene ran upstairs, started observing. Carolyn thought, "Why did I do this wrong? Let me figure this out." And she starts figuring things out and looking at charts, taking out the atlas, and finally saying, "Gene, I don't know where this field is. I can't recognize a single star on this field." Gene is guiding the telescope upstairs, 12.1 stairs above. And Gene has been stewing also. And Carolyn says, "Gene, I can't find what field this is." Gene takes the paddle and says, "Henry, take over." He jumps out of the chair, leaps over the railing, walks down, runs downstairs. They finally figure it out. If they had taken the wrong field, that the correct field was some 20 degrees, a good portion across the sky, away. "Well, that explains why you can't figure out where this field is, Carolyn," Gene said triumphantly, and started to walk upstairs again. Carolyn says, "Just before you go," Gene says, "if this isn't David's comet, what comet is this?" The next day, Comet Shoemaker-Holt was announced to the world. Why am I telling you this story? Because this is how we met. When the orbit was finally published of Comet Shoemaker-Holt, anyone looking at the elements that say where the comet is, its eccentricity, the type of path that it's taking around the sun, you could see easily that the numbers were close. It looked like these comets were two cars speeding down the same highway, with mine 3 months ahead of theirs. Finally, it turned out that this comet had been one comet, and that 12,000 years ago, it had split apart into two for no good reason, except that Shoemaker-Levy comets tend to split apart. Well, I can't imagine a better way for three good friends to meet than through their comets in space. And right now, Comet Shoemaker-Holt is way out in space, probably way beyond the orbit of Uranus. Comet Levy just a little bit ahead of it, but by the time they both come back, 12,000 years from now, they'll be centuries apart. But the friendship, the fun that the three of us have had between 1989 and 1994 has been something special. It has been the most special thing in my entire life. Carolyn Shoemaker.
Why observing with David has been a very special thing for Kate and me also. I think we've had more laughter, maybe a few tears, a lot of tribulation, but a great deal of joy in observing together. That makes the opportunity to give this talk tonight especially meaningful to me. I'm grateful to all of you to come here as Ruth Northcott lecturer. It's the second time I've had a chance to speak in Canada to a group, to the Royal Astronomical Society. Second time that I'm actually going to say something about PSL9 to a group here. And it's especially fun to talk to a group that loves astronomy, as I do. I think there is no group outside of an amateur professional group in astronomy that can share the enthusiasm. This past spring, I had the opportunity to speak in Japan, and I spoke to a group that, so far as I knew, only spoke Japanese, and maybe some of whom understood English. That's a little different circumstance. It's truly nice to speak to people who understand English and who understand a love of astronomy. This past December, Jean and I concluded our program that we had done with David Levy and with Henry Holt at the Palomar 18-inch telescope. That was a wonderful program that produced a lot of results. But in December, we had concluded that it was time to stop, to move on, that while we could continue and could find more things of interest, we were being beaten at our own game. It was time to try something new. But it was a project that achieved a great deal at a time that not too much was being done in a serious way with the discovery of asteroids and comets. And I want to tell you a little bit then about the background of Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, how we came to find it, just exactly what we did and what we accomplished in those years that led up to the grand finale, the comet of the century. Let's have the first slide, please. Maybe we can have the lights down. Yeah.
Can we take them all the way down?
Sure. Jane and I started the program. The Palomar Asteroid and Comet Survey in the fall of 1982 at Palomar Observatory, not far from San Diego, California. We had some of the best instruments that were possible at the time. The 18-inch Schmidt telescope at Palomar was something that some people didn't think was so wonderful, but we knew was really a vital workhorse in our search for asteroids. The 18-inch Schmidt, as you know, is a camera. It enabled us to cover a great deal of sky in one film and in one field. And it made possible, over the years, many, many discoveries. You see here this little telescope that made possible the discovery of almost more comets than the other telescopes at Palomar, and certainly the discovery of more near-Earth asteroids. Let's go on to the next slide, please. This is the happy observing team. See Jean Shoemaker here. Henry Holt. Henry Holt was a retired geologist with the U.S. Geological Survey, who one day came to Jean and me and said, "I really like looking at the skies, and I think I like observing a little bit. Could I go with you sometime to the telescope at Palomar?" We said, "Sure, come along." Gene and I were really ready for this. We have been taking films for a number of years, just the two of us. And that meant, at that time, because we were using a 2AD film, which was very fast, but which was pretty grainy, it meant that we would take as many on a long summer, a long winter's night as 96 films. That was rather exhausting, climbing up David's 12.1 stairs, because we had to run upstairs and downstairs all night long. First Gene would observe, and then I would observe, and the other person would run up and down the stairs. And the next day, Gene would do all the developing while I did all the upkeep of records, looking at films, trying to find out just where we were going. When Henry came, we realized it was really vital to us to have three people. It meant we could observe all night long and still develop the films, so we would be ready to go the next day. It was in 1987 that Henry joined us. And then in 1989, when David came to join us too. David, incidentally, has much the same humor as Frank Shipley. And if you know Frank's humor, you know that we had a great time. Let's have the next slide, please. Here we are with the 18-inch telescope dome at Palomar. Behind is the 200-inch. You can't quite tell the proportions here. The 18-inch looks almost as big as the 200-inch, but it really isn't. Next slide, please. We had another secret weapon. We started using this, Jane and I, from the first year that we started observing together at Palomar. This is the stereo microscope. And our procedure was to take two films of each field, approximately 45 minutes to an hour apart. This was a wonderful way, I found, to discover interesting things, because in those 45 minutes to an hour, there was enough parallax between two films that the objects close by would appear to float. To me, it was much better than the old blink machines, and those are all right if you like blinking lights, but if you're going to examine films hour after hour, it's very nice not to have that, and it's very exciting be able to see things in stereo. One eye would look at one film of a pair, one eye would look at the other, and then that wonderful tool that we all have, the brain, would combine the images. Comets and asteroids floated. If you have good stereo vision, you know that that's a real joy when it comes to looking for things. So this was our secret weapon. With this instrument, I could examine a pair of films in 20 minutes' time. Sometimes a little bit slower if we were in the middle of the Milky Way. And we were not often in the middle of the Milky Way after the first year or two. In fact, we avoided that carefully. Let's go on to the next slide. This is an example of one kind of object that we looked for. We were interested when we started out, particularly in finding near-Earth asteroids, the emphasis on asteroids that might cross the orbit of the Earth. This is an Aten, a special group of asteroids whose orbit crosses the orbit of the Earth when they are farthest away from the Sun. That means that they're in an inner group, and we do not find too many of those. Let's go on to the next view. This was really the impetus for the search in the beginning. When Gene worked on his PhD, he started to work on Meteor Crater. Meteor Crater became a very special place. You might almost say it's a sacred place in the Shoemaker family. This was made by a near-Earth asteroid. And he was interested in finding more craters, in finding out more about the objects that made these craters. Let's go on, please. As the years progressed and we discovered more near-Earth asteroids, we also learned that the Earth resides in a comet swarm. Not a comet swarm, an asteroid swarm. Comets too. But asteroids, particularly in those days. This was an image made by Rick Minsel at MIT. And it has about 100 orbits of near-Earth asteroids, those that cross the orbit of the Earth. I think we're ready for the first view graph, Jake. And we'll have the projector off, please.
You might point out the orbit of the Earth.
Too late. This is an interesting talk because it's not often that a wife will give a talk with her husband present on the first time, at least, that she gives it. And that she has to live up to someone who speaks as well as David Leahy. And that she has to live up to someone who has as many high hopes as Frank Shepley. This is a listing, which I hope you will all read carefully. The few minutes that I'm going to speak about it, I can tell you that it is a list of the near-Earth asteroids that we've discovered. It contains here approximately 48, but altogether we have discovered a good deal more, 87 detections of near-Earth asteroids, only 48 of which are our original discovery. 26 we found independently, but we were not the first to report. 4 that we found were lost. And 9 of the asteroids we discovered were numbered objects already that we found as we went across our films, not looking for them. Up here we have the Ottens. There are 4 of those. We have 21 Apolls, 17 Amors, and 6 near Amors. The Apollos are the asteroids that have orbits which cross the orbits of the Earth. I explained Ottens earlier. They cross the orbit of the Earth at their aphelion, when they're farthest from the Sun. All of the Amors are not Earth-crossing. They're called Amors, I guess, because their orbits come in and kiss the orbit of the Earth, or come very close. And there are some other exciting objects, the near Amors, which may become Earth-crossing at some date in the future. These were important to us because we were interested in knowing the numbers and being able to estimate the total population of near-Earth asteroids, with the end in view of knowing what the collision rates with the Earth might be. And the estimates that Gene has made in his work of collision and of impact with the Earth are based entirely on that summary that you saw. From that, we learned that the total population of Earth-crossing asteroids that are equal to or greater than the Earth at a magnitude of 17.7 is approximately 1,000. The average collision probability with the Earth, that looks a little wild, is simply 4.3 per billion years. The cratering rate for 20 kilometer diameter craters, or smaller, is 3.7 per million square kilometers per billion years. It's a little hard to absorb in one sitting, but there's a pretty good rate, and yet not something that we're going to worry about overnight. We have the same sort of comparison because about 60% of the Earth-crossing asteroids are also Venus-crossing, so that we get these numbers, approximately 600 that are either equal to or less than 17 points.
Brighter.
You want to give the lecture? Let's go on to the next Another category of asteroids that we found as we went along were Mars crossers. The Mars crossers were interesting to us for a number of reasons. Many of those can also become Earth crossing at some time. And we're interested in all of the asteroids with unusual motion. We've had fun naming these. You notice a few names up here probably that you know. You probably know the name of Alvarez for Walter and Louis Alvarez, who did a lot, Walter still, with the Chicxulub crater and the impact in Yucatan. You may not be so familiar with George, who was a very unusual man. That was Jane's father. But you may know another name here. I do believe that's Peter Jedecky up there, as well as Robert Jedecky and his sister. There are a total of 67 Mars crossers that we have found. Next. The Mars crossers fall in several groups. Two of the groups that I've been particularly interested in are illustrated here. And we can tell something about them, at least I could if I could read it. They're high in inclination. You notice they're up here closer to 20 degrees, going on up to 30 degrees. And this tells us something about their semi-major axis. Over here, we have the Hungaria group. Over here, we have the Fakaya group. Those are always exciting to discover because they are so high in inclination. But there are others that are not so highly inclined. These are divided by the new six by the new 16 here, and by the 3-2-1 commensurability right here. All of these, of course, can become impactors on Mars. Let's go ahead. Here you can see their position in relation to their semi-major axis. This is the perihelion distance of Mars. This, or the average perihelion distance of Mars. This is the aphelion distance right here. And sometimes, because that distance can change, it's out here. But you can see that these Hungarians tend to be out here farther. And the blue, which are the Fakayas, are in closer. The stars actually indicate those that become Jupiter crossing. And those are of great interest to us too. Now then, there's another group that we're interested in. This plot was made a few years ago. Here you have the Sun, the Earth, Mars, and Jupiter out here. And this is the main asteroid belt. But there are two swarms of asteroids that we're particularly interested in. These are the L4 and the L5 Trojans that follow the orbit of Jupiter 60 degrees on each side. At the time that we started, there were not many of these known, and it was not known as to how many we could expect to find in that particular group. We found one quite incidentally one year. It's become known as Paris. And because we found it, we became interested in a whole other group of asteroids that we hadn't really been looking for. We started a search for those asteroids. Some of you have read Dick Preston's group, a book, First Light, and he describes the beginning of that search. And it's partly due to Dick Preston that we continued the search because he needed to know the answer to put into his book. And so he came with us. We searched for Trojan asteroids, and in the end, we found more than were known at the time that we started altogether. This is a list of the Trojans discovered in our project. And you note that all but a few here are named by now. We know the orbits well. There are a number of things that came out of this. Importantly to us, we learned that the two swarms are just about the same size. It was thought originally that the L4 swarm was much bigger than the L5. And we found that that was truly an observing factor that gave that impression. One swarm had not been very well observed. It was also thought that one swarm was much brighter than another. And that was not the case. This shows a bit of the evolution of our search. There were, in 1985, this many that were numbered. There were high-precision orbits for this many in 1987, all discoveries by that time. Van Houten had made an estimate from his search on the 48-inch Schmidt of Palomar, and he estimated a curve that looked like this. But Shoemaker and Wolf in 1989 estimated a population that went like this. The next slide, please. We learned from this and from the plots then that those two swarms were about the same size, that they were also about the same magnitude. There were smaller ones in the L4 swarm than in the L5, but that may have had something to do with the collision rate, not because there was a preferential number in one swarm over the other. Next paragraph. Which brings us to the love of my life, comets. And this is a list of the comets discovered in the course of the 12 years at Palomar on the 18-inch Schmidt by the Shoemaker, Levy, Holt, and especially Shoemaker, Levy, T. About half of these are periodic comets, about half are long period. One of these, you note, is a rediscovery of a comet that had been lost and whose orbit had been changed drastically by Jupiter. Let's go. We were interested in the two kinds of comets, the long period comets, for example, had a lot to tell us, and the calculations have been made from the comets that we've discovered. The long period comets appear to be linear in their numbers. If you extrapolate the curve on up, eventually you would come to the Oort cloud, thought to be the source of the long period comets. And we can say that there are at least 20 trillion comets extrapolated from the numbers that we have found in the Oort cloud. There may be more. This curve may be considerably steeper, in part because the comets that are discovered out at the distance of Jupiter are not usually turned on. They're harder to detect. In fact, they get harder to detect after you reach 3 astronomical units. They simply don't degas as much. Another factor has to do with the size of telescope looking. And we went about as faint always as we could with a small telescope. There is another factor, which is the loss cone in the asteroids that as they approach the sun. There are many that simply disappear at that point. But when all the numbers are in and the extrapolation is made, this curve is probably steeper, more linear, and there are more comets in the Oort cloud than we have known before. The other group of comets that we're particularly interested in are the Jupiter family comets. These are the comets that have orbits less than 20 years, or 20 years. Shorter, I should probably say. In 1982, Shoemaker and Wolf made the estimates and based their curve as to how many there were. And this was the that they came up with, extrapolated to this. Those figures changed somewhat when we had completed our survey. We found the curve steeper. There are more of them. These are important comets to us. Some of those can be Earth impactors. Even as exciting as the long period comets. Let's go on. There's another group of comets that we haven't known much about before. They were known about theoretically. These we call extinct comets. You might call them moribund comets. They simply are not active. As they approach the sun a number of times, they build up a slag on the surface. They cease to degas or to de-dust, and they look exactly like asteroids on our films. You can't pick them out just by looking for a corona or a tail. Not many have been found, but they're an area that is covered between the existence of active comets and asteroids. There are probably more extinct comets than any other kind, and they present an ever-present danger to the planets and to the Earth. These are some that we have found, not quite all. Can we have the next slide, please? Most of you have seen the discovery image of P. Shoemaker VV9. This is a good example of Murphy's Law and should have been amongst those films that were looked at last night as examples of Murphy's Law. Virtually everything that could have gone wrong went wrong before we took this pair, and yet it was still a highly successful pair. It was upon this pair that we found PSL9 then, about at this point in 1993. Let's have the next slide. This, of course, was the discovery image of PSL9 highly magnified. The squashed comet that looked like a bar of light with a coma and with a tail. Next slide. Over the ensuing months, you remember that on Mauna Kea, Dave Jewett and Jane Liu took a series of films, of images, I should say. And over the months that followed the discovery, the comet gradually spread out. These are all to the same scale. You can see the evolution of PS09. Next slide. In those weeks and months that followed the discovery, we learned three particularly exciting things. The first thing we knew almost immediately, and that was that this was a comet that was broken truly catastrophically into more pieces than anyone had ever seen with a comet. The second thing we learned in a few weeks after more than 100 positions had been taken, and that was that this was a comet that was in orbit around Jupiter. That was something that no one had ever seen before. Needless to say, our team was ecstatic. This was going to be very nice, and I was assured by a comet expert that this was a comet I was going to see many years to come. Little did he know, as we discovered on May 22nd, the birthday of a famous personage by the name of Levy, that this comet was going to impact Jupiter. That was really beyond our wildest dreams. And my first reaction was, oh no, I'm going to lose a comet at last. Those of you like Doug George who have found comets know that you get to feeling very personal about a discovery like that. You don't want to lose one. So my first feeling was one of dismay. Jane's was one of joy. For many years, Jane had dreamt that sometime he might have a chance to see the impact of a body, perhaps on Earth. He envisioned something that would hit in the middle of the outback of Australia while we were there, and we would rush over and map it. Needless to say, this would be smaller than Chicxulub. It would be smaller than PSL9 was. But he knew that we were destined to learn a great deal about comets, a great deal about what it would mean to be hit by a comet when this occurrence took place. We were pretty nervous about it. We all knew the Kohoutek effect. We didn't want to have people disappointed again. I think astronomers all over the world held their breath at the idea of seeing an impact, of knowing what one would actually be like on another planet. Next slide, please. In January of 1994, we were very fortunate. Hubble Space Telescope was repaired. And we saw these beautiful images as they tried to find out exactly what the size of the nuclei were that made up PSL9. This was the beautiful naming that was given to those objects. You notice a few things missing. And then you see the evolution of the Gang of Four. Next slide, please. On the night that the comet impact occurred, or it was certainly night for us back at Baltimore at the Space Telescope Science Institute, we held our breaths. Happily, we didn't have to hold them too long, and then we discovered that, sure enough, the reports from Spain, Colorado, and elsewhere were true. We saw for the first time the plume rise above Jupiter. One of the intriguing things about these plumes that occurred with a number of the nuclei was the fact that they all seemed to rise just about to the same height. The
those from the smaller fragments, like A, which we hadn't really expected to see a plume from necessarily, or those from the bigger fragments, like G and K and L. All rose approximately to 3,000 feet before they started to collapse. Next slide. One of the most striking things we saw, and one of the things that we were most interested in learning about, were the results from that impact. You see here the black eye that took place following those impacts. That was of great significance to us. We were intrigued by the outer ring of dark material, by an inner core of even darker material. That told us something about what was being put into the atmosphere of Jupiter. And we were also intrigued, and that doesn't show in this particular slide, by a ring that was within this area here. It was a gravity ring. And why we should see a gravity ring was the subject of intensive examination and exploration after the impacts. Next slide, please. We learned something by the very bright flashes of light then that we saw as the impacts took place. This was the K impact as seen from Australia. This flash was not the actual first plume. It was not the actual flash of the meteorite. It was the material that came up in that plume as it fell back and hit the atmosphere. When it was in the plume at the top, it was cooling very rapidly. When the material started coming down and fell back, it heated up much higher than anyone had realized, and you got this very bright flash. Next slide, please. We were very fortunate that Hubble was repaired. We were able to get a number of wonderful images that could be seen and which went out over internet to virtually anyone who had an interest in looking at the images by computer. Here you see a number of the sites where fragments hit. This was probably the first time that there had ever been so much interchange between scientists and between the amateur astronomers and between just anyone who was interested in the impact and what was happening. Information flowed very freely. It's the first time, I think, that we've ever seen a group exchange information without trying to put a fence around it and say, I got a lot, but I'm not going to tell you. This is mine, and when I publish, you'll know. Everyone knew right away, and everyone gained during the impact of PSL9. Next slide, please. There were some wonderful images taken by the amateur astronomers. I was really impressed, and I continue to be impressed with what they have done with CCDs. Don Parker's images taken in Florida were some of the best, and you can see the dark spots here as they gradually evolved during the time of impact. Next slide. We were fortunate indeed that we had a spacecraft out approaching Jupiter. That same spacecraft will give us more images back than we have had already, but it is on its way to Jupiter and will arrive there in December of this year. These are the images taken by Galileo. Galileo could see the meteor as it approached. Now, there's nothing in this image. These images were taken approximately 2.5 seconds apart. Here is the flash of the meteor. this is the resulting plume and the fallback. And here is the fourth image, showing us what the spacecraft was able to tell us. Much to our surprise, Hubble Space Telescope took an image at exactly the same time that Galileo took this image. So we have two images of the last of the nuclei impacting Jupiter. That was fragment W. Next slide. In the following weeks, we all watched with some wonderment as the impact sites spread out. Here we are on July 18th, the date of the G impact, and this is the G-D complex. You see what had happened to it in the course of a few days. It's beginning to spread out, and this dark material here is some of the dark material farther out. But from the core of the plume, here came some more dark material. And you can follow that evolution on as you go. It spread out farther in this direction, and it spread out in latitude. Next slide, please. This image taken by Phil Nicholson on the 200-inch telescope at Palomar told us a little bit about what was happening, at least in the infrared. This actually shows all of the impact sites on July 24th and 25th. A few weeks later, only some of them still looked as bright in the infrared. And by August, they were truly smeared out. This smearing of the impact sites was something that David Levy was able to observe on his telescope in Tucson and is still reporting to me regularly as I ask him, what has happened to the dark spots on Jupiter? Can you still see what happened? And he tells me there is still a band and you can still see the dark material from the comet. Next slide. This image is a composite also by Phil Nicholson on the 200-inch telescope. Here you see all of the impact sites. And this, of course, is a computer enhancement and a computer angle that we're looking at. We're down south of Jupiter looking up. And you can see how the fragments were all the way around, but perhaps more of them in this particular area. I think it's a beautiful picture. Maybe because I like the subject. Next slide, please. Paul Chodas at JPL did a lot of work on the history of this comet. As David told you, it was probably captured in 1929 into the orbit of Jupiter. But it could have been captured other years. Not too much chance in here. But in 1850, there was a possibility that it could have been captured in orbit about Jupiter. We've been interested in the history because we would particularly like to find prior images, images that were taken that might have the comet upon it sometime before the discovery. It would help us a lot to know something about the orbit of Jupiter, of the comet, before it came into orbit about Jupiter, if we could find other images. So far, the images, the films, the photographs that have been taken of Jupiter in prior years have not revealed the comet to any of us. Next slide, please. Last of all, we have a projection of the G impact fragment if it had happened upon Earth, if the impact had occurred on Earth, perhaps up here around Greenland. Know that real dark core, that ring out here, and this very dark cloud. Actually, that dark cloud would have 90 minutes if it had been upon the earth. This tells us a great deal about what to expect, what to think about in an occurrence of a collision with Earth. There are a number of things that we find particularly important as results of the comet impact on Jupiter. First of all, people have really learned, if they had any doubts before, and many of them did, that rocks do fall out of the sky, that things that are not as strong as rocks may fall out of the sky and make a terrific impact upon a planet. If things like this can happen to Jupiter, they can happen to the Earth. And this last summer, we did have proof of that. Secondly, we learned something about the composition of the comet. We learned, for one thing, that it was much more fragile than any of us had thought that comets were. Perhaps all comets are more fragile. Or perhaps some comets are fragile and some are much more cohesive. There may be a variety there. So we need, perhaps, to send a mission to a comet. Time to learn something more about the cometary world. We saw all that dark material that came from PSL9. That has real bearing upon what would happen here on Earth. If you had dark material like that put up into our atmosphere and it covered the whole Earth for a period of time, you might not have a mass extinction, but it would become more than uncomfortable. At the right time of year, or the wrong time of year, we might say, you might lose a growing season. You might have complete loss of crops. You might have starvation in magnified amplitude throughout the Earth. This would affect not only people directly, but it would affect all life forms. It's hard to say how much would survive after something of that nature. We learned quite a bit about the winds of Jupiter, where material spreads out. The material that was extremely high spread out very quickly with high winds on Jupiter. The material that was lower, of course, did not spread so fast. We have been able to see a little bit about the circulation patterns there. Some people have said, was there water? Almost certainly. Most of the water, and there was a great deal of water, most of the water that was seen came from the comet. And that is of some significance. It was a comet, and it showed its character there. We've learned other things about the composition of Jupiter, the material that was brought up. There have been 3 conferences since the impact on PSL9, many, many papers given, a great deal of study. Probably this impact and the comet and Jupiter have been more heavily studied than Halley was at the time that Halley came by this last time. And people were really prepared to learn a lot then. All of us can be truly thankful that the comet impact occurred on Jupiter.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we're truly thankful that we discovered it.
At this time, I'd like to introduce and call up our national president, Dr. Doug Hugh, to give an official thank you.
ladies and gentlemen, this evening's lecture is given in honor and in memory of Ruth J. Northcott, and I'd like to say a few words about Ruth before I directly thank Carolyn. There are a few people in the audience tonight who knew Ruth personally. For approximately, I believe there may be a slide, is there? No slide? What, wrong slide? That's, keep going. There we are. That is Ruth Northcott. Ruth was on the academic staff of the Department of Astronomy, University of Toronto, for approximately 3 decades. She died at a much too early age in 1969. She served the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada for many, many years, decades, in a number of ways. In particular, she was for several decades editor of the journal, and more particularly, she was the second editor of the Observer's Handbook, succeeding C.A. Chant after he had served for approximately 50 years. And indeed, she was editor of the handbook at the time of her death in 1969. Those of us who knew Ruth will remember her as a very warm, generous individual, generous with her time and advice to her students, of which I had the honor of being one, and equally generous with her time and the effort that she put into the affairs of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. I think it's entirely appropriate that this evening's lecture was given by an individual who you will agree, as a result of our all too brief meetings with her over the last couple of days, is an equally warm and generous individual who loves her science clearly as much as Ruth Northcott did. And I think we have been honored, and I'm sure if Ruth is, in some sense, watching tonight's affairs, she would feel equally honored that her lecture was given by Dr. Carolyn Shoemaker. So I thank Carolyn, I thank Jean and David Levy, the entire group, especially Carolyn, for honoring us with their presence. Thank you very much.